From the studios of Farm Journal Broadcast, this is U.S. Farm Report.
Welcome to U.S. Farm Report. I'm Clinton Griffiths in for Tyne Morgan. Now, as we've been anticipating, Tyne and husband James welcome daughter Kimbrel Marie into the world Monday morning. Both mom and baby are doing well. Of course, that means while Tyne is on maternity leave, I'll be here doing my best to fill in. To that end, here's what we're working on for you this Thanksgiving weekend. Big elections. Argentinian voters could have a real impact on grain prices here at home. Market movement during a holiday week.
This price of 360, 370 corn is too cheap. I think it's very relative, and I think it could be a lot longer at that level, barring some sort of weather event.
Weather in the week ahead.
And if you're wondering what the weather's going to be like over the next 90 days, I'll have your winter forecast coming up.
And snow is filling John's world.
The first snow, it's a special thing.
Plus, we're celebrating the season. It's our annual Harvest of Thanks tribute to America's farmers and ranchers.
U.S. Farm Report, brought to you by the dependable, long-lasting Chevy Silverado.
Now for the news that moved the markets this week. The U.S. dollar seeing volatility this week, continuing to force swings in commodities. The currency trading at its highest point in 8 months Monday before falling back. Wall Street is watching the Fed for directions on interest rates. It's expected to make a decision in the next couple of weeks. Cheers from a crowd as Argentina voters select Mauricio Macri. He's expected to devalue the currency and lift export taxes, and that could bring a flood of stored grain to market. Some estimates say the supply is worth roughly $8 billion. Now, if that happens, U.S. markets could feel the increased competition.
If we do get the reduction in the export taxes like Macri has promised, then it could really be some major changes down the road. So short-term impacts to the corn market, the soybean market, and the wheat market with potentially more supply coming from Argentina, both short-term and long-term here.
South Korea is reopening its markets to U.S. poultry. That's according to Politico. The country put up restrictions during the avian influenza outbreak earlier this year. State officials say the ban is coming off after months of discussions between Washington and Seoul officials. Meanwhile, South Korea also dealing with an outbreak of its own. 12 cases of high path avian flu have been reported there this week alone. Ag Secretary Tom Vilsack says the Chinese government is moving quickly to finish reviews of biotech crops. After meeting in China for bilateral talks, Vilsack says the Chinese are currently reviewing 11 agricultural biotech events pending approval. They're also continuing a dialogue on access for U.S. beef. The beef market has been closed to the U.S. since 2003. Vilsack says he hopes for action over the next 30 to 60 days. USDA rolling out the October cattle on feed numbers. The number of cattle and calves on feed climbed 2% from a year ago, coming in at 10.8 million head. However, placements into feedlots last month dropping 4% as owners either refuse or are unwilling to pay current prices. The Sterling Profit Tracker says last week feed yards were losing an average of $542 per head. And cattle moving out of the yard or marketings also in October, they were down 3% year over year to the lowest point in 19 years. The latest crop progress report indicating most of the major crops are now out of the field. Cotton harvest remains sluggish with only 70% harvested nationwide. And while 96% of winter wheat is in the ground, some key southern states, North Carolina and Texas, well, they're behind their five-year averages. 53% of the wheat crop now rated good to excellent. Those are the headlines. Meteorologist Mike Hoffman joins us now with weather. And Mike, we're switching things up this morning. You're starting off with our long-range outlook. Should we expect more storms like last week?
Thanks, Clinton. Actually, I think we will, but more than likely, the storm track will shove farther and farther south as we head into winter. But it's kind of an interesting setup, even as we head through this weekend and into this coming week with a big old cutoff out west. That always causes issues with computer models. They don't like that, and it's usually something that they have trouble with down the road. So as we put this map into motion, you'll notice how it slowly, as we head through Monday and Tuesday, brings this cutoff a little farther east. Blends it in with the main jet stream, quick shot of cold air later this week in the east, and then it's back to a ridge with a trough underneath. And this is what I think the winter situation is going to set up like, a southern jet stream and a northern jet stream. and how those come together make big differences in the forecast. So let's go through our 90-day outlook. We'll go through the first temperatures month by month, above normal temperatures for the northeast, northern tier of states into the northwest, below normal from the Four Corner region over toward New Orleans and the far western portions of the Florida Panhandle. By January, we'll expand that below normal area just a little bit farther east, still above normal through the northern tier of states. And on to February we go, we'll expand that below normal area all the way to up and down the east coast, with above normal only for the northern plains and the Pacific Northwest. That's kind of the way this whole winter is setting up. 90-day outlook for precipitation, above normal for most of the central and southern states, below normal from the Great Lakes back into the northern Rockies. Clinton?
Okay, thanks, Mike. It was a short trading week, but we'll dig into markets with Dustin Johnson and Tommy Grusoffi right after the break. Stay with us.
Things break all the time and glue never works. What you need is Laser Bond USA, the amazing liquid plastic that fixes virtually anything in as little as 3 seconds. Laser Bond is not a glue, but a unique liquid plastic that only hardens with the UV light. Now fill in plumbing leaks in 3 seconds or less. Instantly repair kids' toys and keep playtime flying. The magic of powerful liquid plastic that hardens under ultraviolet light. The best part, the adhesive is made in the USA.
Wow, that is fast.
It bends, it's flexible.
If you mess up applying, just wipe clean. No sticky residue. Call now to get Laser Bond USA for just $19.99 and receive this protective carry case free. But wait, we're going to double the offer absolutely free and ship your order free. Call now.
Call 1-800-493-6618 to get your Laser Bond USA. Call now or go to laserbondusa.com. So call 1-800-493-6618. Call now.
Welcome back to U.S. Farm Report. Joining us at the desk today, Tommy Grusoffi, Advanced Trading, and Dustin Johnson, E. Hedger. Thank you both for being here. Let's start by taking a look at the macroeconomy, the world as we know it. And boy, things seem to be changing even this week.
Absolutely. So the world's a different place since we were last on the show. There's definitely more risk in the world. I'm not exactly sure how that's affected grain markets yet. I know it's affected the stock market and the currencies, and you know, we might end up saying we're almost becoming aligned with Russia to go fight the bad powers of the world. It's affecting markets. It's affecting currencies. I guess maybe it's a good thing for grains that maybe there's, you know, you're not always just going to be able to import grain from a country and think your ports are safe. But the world's changed. It has an influence on crude oil, and it's play by play, it's changing by the second.
How could that crude oil impact start to bleed over into our other commodities? I mean, if we see that rally early in the week, we saw it up, you know, $1.50 in trade. If that keeps to come up, is that going to change some of our commodity outlook?
I don't necessarily think so. The commodity bust has already happened and is underway. So, to build up that demand again, it's going to take a while. And I also think that the relationship between crude oil and, let's say, corn is much less now than it was back when there was a question of discretionary blending. Knowing that we've got a defined amount of gas we're going to use in this country, that's not going to impact the ethanol use too much, I wouldn't think.
Yeah. What about the dollar, Tommy, with all this stuff happening in the world? How is the dollar impacting us?
Everyone's fear was that the dollars keep rallying, and I don't know who puts in someone's mind that every day that the dollar rallies, that commodities have to go down. They don't have to. And we saw some action like that earlier in the week where the dollar rallied, went to 100, and actually by the end of the day, a lot of the commodities were higher. So, you know, we're possibly looking at moving interest rates in December. We've had a strong dollar. To Dustin's point, that's a lot different than the big bull market we dealt with when we were trying to get out of the low stock market. Our country wanted a low dollar. I don't know that we necessarily want a high dollar, but that's what's happening. So it's affecting the markets. I don't think it's as scary. I think there's bigger fundamental reasons for why corn and wheat and beans are going lower just besides the dollar.
Yeah, what about trade? I mean, are we seeing that impact on trade? I think we are.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Take corn sales, for example. We are running way behind what we should be at this time of year. And our window will eventually start to close. We start to get more competition from other areas of the world again. But right now, we're about 450 million bushels behind where we should be. And I think that's going to make it an impact on our carryout, which, again, is a supply-side issue that's not good for price.
Yeah. One of those impacts that we could see in world markets is happening in Argentina as they transition to a new president, Tommy.
Right. Big week in Argentina. A lot of rumors flying around that the taxes were going to be taken away. We'll see. As people know in the States, you know, politicians will say anything to get elected. I guarantee there will be some changes, and there is going to be some grain flowing out of Argentina that the world may have known it's there, but it hasn't been able to hit the market. So it'll be interesting. I think it played out into that dollar trade also, where we had just a basket full of bearish news, strong dollar, Argentine election, and soybeans traded up. It's interesting.
Yeah, it is interesting. What do you think about the Argentina situation?
Well, a lot's still to be known about it. Like Tommy was saying, we get to December 10th, and that's when Macri is going to take over the country again. And at that point, he'll get a better idea of what the country's finances are in and what kind of incentives he needs to place to get producers to sell their grain. So it's been rumored that maybe a 90-day window where they'll completely eliminate the export tax for soybeans. They're holding on to a massive amount of beans on farm, and you know, close to 500 million bushels to get down to what Brazil's carryout level currently is. So if that size was to hit the market in a short time span, let's say that 90-day window, that's going to be, I would say, very detrimental for U.S. sales and just for prices in general, because it's just what the market probably wouldn't be able to handle on its own.
You agree, Tommy?
A little bit, but I question, is Argentina organized enough and have the rail and the truck and the road structure to, they have the grain, we know that, I agree. Can they get it out to the market in a timely manner?
Can they ramp back up as we get through this? Real quick, interest rates, both of you think that's gonna happen or not happen, or does it matter?
It matters, but I was so confident they were gonna do something a few months ago, and I think the Fed's caught in a terrible conundrum where they just, if they say they're going to raise rates, the stock market goes down, and the Fed should not care what the stock market does. And every time they open their mouth, again, they make the dollar stronger, which makes commodities go down, which makes most people watching this show sad. and so you could blame the Fed. But they'll figure it out. I hope we haven't become Japan.
All right. Well, we'll keep an eye on it. We'll have more to talk about in just a few minutes. We'll be back right after this.
So, we're the first soybean brand of our kind.
Yep, called Credenz. We're backed by Bayer Crop Science.
We stand up better to tough weeds.
Because we've got the best choices in herbicide-tolerant traits.
We're better than your average soybeans.
Go to credenz.bayer.com to find a local retailer.
We are producers, independent thinkers, and big picture dreamers. We're about getting things done, challenging traditions, and starting a few of our own. We are Kubota.
Introducing new Credenz soybeans, made using smart genetics. Credenz offers choices for handling tough weeds. They're not your average soybeans. Visit credenz.bayer.com to find your nearest retailer.
You're somewhere between trying to beat your previous best yield and trying to figure out how to beat the odds. You love working the land, but hate wasting effort. What's the smartest way forward? We're here to help you challenge the status quo and raise the bar on what's possible. We're BASF. You're drowning in options. We give you a personalized plan. You hear big promises every day, We deliver some of the best chemistry in agriculture. You face big risks. We put skin in the game to help protect you. Let's dream of places you can go on land you'll never leave. Let's grow smart together. Because the chemistry we create on your farm is just as important as the chemicals we create in the lab. Together, let's get you the most, acre after acre, season after season, generation after generation. BASF, we create chemistry.
Welcome back to U.S. Farm Report. Tommy Grisafi, Dustin Johnson, our guests here today. Dustin, what's a fair price for corn right now?
That's a very good question. I think the biggest answer to that would be what price are we going to get to reduce acres in the U.S. next year?
Okay.
You know, is it $9 NOVE 16 soybean futures? Is it $4 D 16 corn? I don't think so. That's the sole answer to that. Without a weather event somewhere around the world, we're probably at a fair price, maybe even at risk of going lower since how poor demand has been. Mm-hmm. We talked about the poor corn export sales. So my whole point to that is this huge injection that Argentina is getting. You're going to see an increase in acreage next year, especially on the corn side, depending on how that tax implication is. That's one more competitor we're going to have again for our corn exports around the world. So we are no longer the low-cost producer around the world, and I think that to say that, okay, well, this price of 360, 370 corn is too cheap, I think it's very relative. And I think it could be a lot longer at that level, barring some sort of weather event.
All right, you agree, Tommy, or no?
In some ways, yeah, we can't predict the weather or world events, but take something that's not grain related, like silver. Silver's been trading under the cost of production for several years. Oftentimes on ag marketing shows like this, you hear when grain gets to your cost of production, start marketing it. I think what Dustin and I agree upon is, what if we don't get there? The American farmer needs to learn how to market grain under the cost of production. I'm not happy to say those words. This is just a reality. And yes, the farmer's holding a lot of 15 crop. They're buying seed right now and prepaying for it so they can go produce the 16 crop. They are becoming and getting ready to become long corn again, and so are our friends in South America.
Yeah. To that point, I was just going to say that is one big thing that's not being talked about right now, is that farmers holding on to one of the largest spec positions in the world right now. Storing grain, waiting for the price to go higher. Whether or not that's the right answer is to be seen, but so far a laissez-faire approach to marketing has not been the right answer. And we have to start thinking that maybe these are the prices that are here to stay, and what are we going to do about it? Are we going to continue to pay storage costs to get that increase in price, or are we going to think about put our hats on, think about what's the right answer for my business going forward?
Yeah. Switching gears just a little bit, Tommy, there are good sides to low grain prices for the other side of the coin, which would be our livestock folks.
Sure. One of my friends in livestock always said, if you want to help your friends who grow row crops become better at marketing, have them call a livestock guy once a week, because we don't have the federal crop insurance. We can't store our hogs and cattle. We just can't say, hey, we're going to wait and cattle are going to go up. Let's throw them in this bin. So a livestock guy has a different approach to marketing. Of course, they enjoy the lower priced grain, but even with grains being lower, the numbers still aren't working in livestock. And so a lot of time in our business, in our industry, you hear the word profit. I'm not sure who's profiting in agriculture, but I live a mile from a dairy and he's not happy. I know plenty of row crop people, they're our customers. I work with some livestock people and they all seem to be complaining. And I don't think as a group they're all liars. I think it's truly we are in that challenging of a time. So the word profit is definitely not something that should be just said casually as if it's happening.
Yeah. As we move through the rest of this year and into 2016, what surprises are out there that could take these markets?
We've got yet to be seen what Argentina does, how quick that those bushels come to the market. We also have the funds that have been building a short position, and they're still 50,000 plus contracts away to getting to that short of a position as they were in May. So producers continue to hold on to it. If the investment community continues to sell, that might be the surprise that the market's not aware of, that there's still more shorts to be coming.
Yeah, real quick, Tommy, what
do
you think?
To add to that, when you have a bear market, I think we agree we are in a bear market, is that short covering rallies are vicious. And so we could have a day where we just see corn limit up, and someone, maybe the producer thinks it's the new bull market, but when you get that many shorts all the same way, and something changes, something sparked in the world, we can have limit up days in commodities. Doesn't mean we're out of the bear market, just means we had a vicious short covering rally. the number one thing that can surprise you is how fast we can go up in a bear market.
All right. We'll have more in your Get Your Closing Thoughts here in just a minute in Markets Now. We'll be back right after these messages.
This is Machinery Pete inviting you to check out my new website, MachineryPete.com. Offering farmers tens of thousands of used equipment listings to search, let Machinery Pete help you find and value your next piece of used equipment.
The makers of a number one selling joint supplement at GNC announce a major breakthrough in fast-acting joint relief. Introducing new InstaFlex Advanced, a powerful new formula so advanced it offers joint relief in just 7 days. To celebrate, we're offering complimentary 2-week samples at tryinstaflex.com. Just enter the promo code below. This new fast-acting InstaFlex Advanced formula was formulated by a world-renowned doctor. It's twice as powerful as chondroitin and glucosamine combined. New InstaFlex Advanced is so powerful, now all you need is just one tiny pill a day to get effective joint relief. This is our most powerful formula ever, a breakthrough that takes joint relief to a whole new level. Now you can be one of the first to experience the amazing InstaFlex Advanced difference with a complimentary sample. New InstaFlex Advanced samples are not available in stores. You can only get your complimentary 2-week sample by going to tryinstaflex.com and entering the promo code below. That's tryinstaflex.com.
Do you worry about your mom or dad living alone? I know I did. Hi, I'm Joan London, and there's a free service you need to know about. It's called A Place for Mom. They're the nation's largest senior living referral service, and they can help you find the right senior care fast.
Mom and Dad, we found this place. It's great. You can afford it. You're going to love it. Let's go look at it.
A Place for Mom offers free one-on-one advice from local advisors and a personalized list of senior living communities you can visit. Believe me, I know, I've been there. Finding senior care for a parent can be difficult, but now there's a place for answers, A Place for Mom.
If you're struggling to find reliable senior living information for your mom or dad, then call to get the free help you need during this turbulent time. Call now, 800-243-0190. 800-243-0190. Call 800-243-0190 today.
Welcome back. It's time for Markets Now. Dustin, your closing thoughts?
I would just say that, with the price of corn so depressed, I think there's a big tendency for a lot of producers and for analysts, including, to look for a bottom, try to bottom pick the market. And that's where I would say that there's no shortage of those guys out there. If that's what your goal is, looking for it, you can find them. But to my, keeping to the same point I've been making throughout the show is that it's still a lot more risk than I think people realize. And we're still, 50 cents away from hitting, multi-year contract lows. And I would say just be prepared for, that possibility.
All right. Tommy, what do you think?
Well, looking at my notes, it's been 560 days since front month corn's traded $5. And it could be another 560 days. It could just be 60 days. Markets can surprise you. But the facts are, we're no longer coming on the show talking about that prices can go down. And the time to worry about prices to go down was when we were $7.50 corn. Now that we're $3.50, I think there's still downside risk. I agree with my friend here. But we also have a ton of upside risk. And you need to manage those risks, both upside and downside. And, understand that. You talk to people in the cattle industry and you say, how do you make money in the cattle industry? And they say, you got to buy them right. My advice for the American farmer is to buy those inputs right, work out those land rents, and let the market do its own on going back to higher prices.
All right. Good advice, both of you. Thank you both for being here. John Phipps joins us right after the break with John's World.
I really was worried about the year when we started because it was the driest I'd seen it.
The last several years, it's been dry here.
You only get one chance to plant corn, and you better plant the right one.
We're putting a lot of faith in our dealer and our account rep to assist us in picking out a good package.
This corner of the state, we avoided a lot of the early season rains.
If you don't have a good stand to start with, you can't raise a top notch corn crop. You just can't do it.
The planting season turned out a lot better than we thought. The hybrids did really well in the cool, wet conditions.
I like to think when we started out, we got 250 bushel out in the field.
I think our corn crop looks good to excellent.
This year, crops really look good. we're hoping for 240, 250 bushel.
Some people tend to dream small. Others dream big. But with agriculture's ability to feed the 1 billion hungry people on the planet and a projected global population of 9 billion by the year 2050, it's time to dream huge. Farmers Feeding the World is about agriculture coming together to increase both hunger solutions and food production. Learn more. Give generously. Please dream huge with us.
Hi, this is Mark Gold with Top Third Ag Marketing. I have just issued a free workbook on marketing in the top third. This book contains all the major principles from my marketing seminars. And Top Third wants you to try an option at our expense. Included in the book is a coupon good for up to $150 in premium, plus we'll pay the commission and fees. We want you to learn how options can help you become a better marketer. Call 877-TT-HEDGE or visit topthird.com for details.
The phrase "winter is coming," made popular by the HBO TV show Game of Thrones, can't be true forever. As John Phipps tells us, at some point, winter is here.
Ah, the first snow of the season. And if you're in the fields and reasonably caught up in the office, the first snow, especially if it's kind of a surprise, can catch you unaware with its seeming benign beauty. Not yet are the howling blizzards with bone-chilling temperatures just a soft, silent invasion of a crystalline fragility, applying a base coat to the winter landscape. Sufficient unto the day are the long, dark days ahead and road hazards and school closings and snow shovels. Right now, you might as well regress to an 8-year-old who cares nothing about the downside of snow. For me, the first snow has been a white full-screen warning. Winter comes. Usually, like today, it is whispered softly, not a cry of alarm. Your home suddenly seems more inviting, and looking out at the falling flakes can trigger a memory avalanche of snowfalls past. If your circumstances permit, I hope you can enjoy your first snow this year. Maybe it's the natural sound suppression that can dampen the nagging voices of worry for a few hours. Maybe the falling curtain of flakes can help you focus on what is close and worthwhile. Maybe an overexcited child will burst into your moment of reflection and, instead of spoiling its wondrous solitude, provide instead a small explosion of untainted joy. Maybe this will be a time for forgetting. Just as the snow quietly conceals lawns and forgotten lawn tools, unraked leaves and scarred sod, maybe you will find respite in just watching and letting go of all but this moment. And above all, maybe you'll only get 4 inches or so.
So true. Thanks, John. And stay with us for our annual Harvest of Thanks Holidays special. It's coming up next. John returns with an inspiring message. Plus, we traveled to Plymouth Rock, along the East Coast, and through the panhandle of Texas, celebrating the hard work and bounty of America's farmers and ranchers. Harvest of Thanks begins right after the break.
U.S. Farm Report is produced and distributed by Farm Journal Broadcast.
Thanksgiving, an American tradition celebrating the gifts of harvest.
A time when families share life's abundance and take time to recognize the efforts of their labor.
I'm Clinton Griffiths.
And I'm Tyne Morgan.
And today we celebrate a harvest of thanks. America's farmers and ranchers dedicate their lives to feeding and clothing our country and millions of others across the globe.
And Clinton, while that work isn't always easy, it's years of fulfillment for generations of work and effort. As farm families scratch an existence from the land, create an agricultural system envied by the world and beyond the dreams of our forefathers.
Now, hundreds of years later, we still celebrate and give thanks for a year's harvest. Andrew McCrae takes us back to where it all began.
In the fall of 1620, the Mayflower left England with 102 passengers that we today call the Pilgrims. Their ship eventually landed here at what is today Plymouth, Massachusetts.
They spend the winter of 1620, 1621 building their houses and unfortunately digging graves. They lost about half the members of the planting company over the course of that first winter.
In early April of 1861, the Mayflower headed back to England. That spring, the Pilgrims were introduced to a native named Squanto. He had been captured from the area in 1614 and taken to Europe. After 5 years in England, he found an opportunity to come home.
He then manages to get back to New England, comes back over, makes his way back to his hometown of Patuxet, only to find that by 1619, everyone is either dead or has fled to other villages.
It was the cleared ground from that prior Native American village that the Pilgrims began to cultivate. In the fall of 1621, the Native Americans and Pilgrims celebrated their first harvest together. While significant, there's little evidence of what took place at the event we call Thanksgiving.
We really only have one record of what happened on that first Thanksgiving, and it is from the time period. It is from someone who was present, and the letter begins, "The governor sent 4 or 5 men out fowling, and so blah, 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 they rejoiced together in a special manner, the natives having come amongst them." There's not a lot. There's a couple of sentences describing that famous first Thanksgiving.
The event took place sometime in the fall of 1621, but the exact date is not known. Nonetheless, it is the meal that we trace back to the holiday we have today.
We know it went on for approximately 3 days. We know it was attended by at least 100 native people. There were only 51 or 52 English people in the town, so remember, the natives are outnumbering them 2-1.
It was not an annual event, however. More colonists arrived soon after, and there were now more mouths to feed. Today's Plymouth Plantation recounts the struggle of those men, women, and children. The ground is farmed much as it was nearly 400 years ago.
The key to Plymouth's success is not the fishing that they did, but they were a maritime community, and that was an essential part of their daily life and their survival, but they were also an agricultural community. And that, I think, is the part that kind of gets forgotten. We think of them as being here for their church, but in order to support their church's survival here, those who were members and those who were not, they had to eat.
The story of Plymouth is truly one about agriculture. It was farming that sustained that first colony and brought the bounty for a Thanksgiving, a celebration we still have 400 years later. Traveling the countryside in Plymouth, Massachusetts, I'm Andrew McCrae.
All right, thanks, Andrew. While the Midwest stands as the pinnacle of production today, the East Coast remains a very important hub of agrarian output.
And Clinton, those farms may not span across miles of prairie, but farming in the shadow of the nation's capital, well, it comes with both rewards and challenges.
National Corn Grower President Chip Bowling farms near Newburgh, Maryland, which is tucked away near the Chesapeake Bay. For him, harvest is always the first step in preserving a family legacy into another year.
At the southern tip of Maryland, adjacent to a tributary of the Chesapeake Bay.
We're going to start in this field.
You'll find National Corn Grower Association President Chip Bowling and his family farming the land down below.
When I get done combining soybeans, you guys come with the wheat and put the cover crop down and run the turbo till. Uh-oh, here comes Mom.
Harvest.
She'll talk, I can tell you.
It's still a family affair.
Iced tea, watermelon, didn't matter, whatever.
That's for sure.
That was the most important thing, the iced tea.
Their story, like the area, is steeped in U.S. history.
Our family came here in the early 1700s. They were established in Virginia across the Potomac River, about 20 miles from where we're standing. And in the mid-1700s, my great-great-great-grandfather bought some land over here.
The Bowlings developed into grain and cattle producers, but for decades, tobacco was always king.
We probably still would be growing it if there was a good market for it and if the state of Maryland didn't have a buyout back in the late 1990s.
After the buyout came environmental mandates, and soon even cattle didn't pencil out to have so close to the bay. That's when row crops took a front seat. Bowling's crop year is now full of corn, soybeans, and double crop wheat.
I tease with my buddies that I'm on the corn board with National Corn Growers, that I start planting like the end of April and don't really quit planting until the 1st of July, and they can't, like, holy man, you know, unhook the planter and hook that tractor to something else.
Those hours in the cab turned out well for him this harvest. Bowling cut one of his best corn crops ever, and Hurricane Joaquin did not do much damage to his location.
We were actually so dry that we needed the rain.
While weather is out of his control, traveling more than half of the year and living so close to an urban environment has its own challenges.
When we move a combine, sometimes I can have 40 or 50 cars behind me. If it's a holiday weekend, we don't move equipment.
But Bowling isn't just an industry leader and farmer.
We're about 3 miles as the crow flies from the Potomac River.
He's an active sportsman with a love for the bay he grew up on.
I have spent so many days down here as a kid, walking around barefooted in shorts, swimming and crabbing and fishing. So this river means as much to me as any environmentalist in this country, that's for sure.
It's a balance between two passions, farming for maximum yields while protecting the water he enjoys. But he sees every harvest as a celebration, a reminder of why farmers do the job year after year.
You know, it's a good feeling to know that you're doing the same thing that your ancestors did.
Reporting in Newburgh, Maryland, I'm Betsy Gibbon.
All right, thanks, Betsy. Up next, we'll meet another East Coast farmer who represents the nation's soybean growers. He, too, is thankful for a bountiful harvest and the ability to do the work he loves.
And Clinton, later we're off to the Texas Panhandle, where those farmers are thankful for plentiful rains. But first, harvest is one of the most important events each fall. I mean, it all comes down to those final days, but it's also when agriculture's true character shines, especially when adversity gets in the way. So throughout the show, we'll share some of those heartfelt stories of farmers helping farmers. We'll start off in Galva, Illinois for the most amazing harvest. Carl Bates has cancer, but thanks to family, friends, and a day's labor, they were able to get Carl's golden grain out of the field.
U.S. Farm Report, brought to you by the dependable, long-lasting Chevy Silverado.
Is the early application of fungicide profitable on corn? Does it really make me money?
One of the things is you're going across the field anyway with a herbicide, probably a post-emergence herbicide. It's easy and cost-effective to throw a fungicide in the tank with that application. Now, early season, we're trying to do two things. We're trying to protect the leaves in the middle of the canopy and gives good stalk quality. There's a lot of good benefits out of that. When you're going through that field, you're harvesting, you're burning fuel by the hour with your combine. If I have to slow down because my stalks aren't standing well, then I'm increasing my cost per acre. If I'm going to 4 miles an hour, I have to slow down suddenly to 2 miles an hour because my stalks aren't standing straight, I just double the cost of fuel invested in harvesting. Nothing to do with yield, but that's direct money out of my pocket. So the value of an early season fungicide is not just the yield increase, but also the increased efficiency you see through the season. So there's a lot of value from that early season application.
Attention homeowners, taking a bath in your high wall tub is an accident waiting to happen. But now, you can turn your existing tub or shower into a safe, easy-entry tub in just one day. With no tub walls to climb over, just open the door and walk right in, and the raised safety seat lets you bathe in comfort. Our easy-entry tubs are made in the USA with vital safety features, like a slip-resistant floor, ultra-low threshold, and watertight door with lifetime warranty. Now, you can enjoy the healing benefits of water therapy safely and easily.
I use it for everything. For bathing, for relaxing, and I don't have to worry.
So stop risking injury when you bathe. Our affordable, easy-entry tubs offer you the best safety value and service with factory-trained installation in just one day. For a limited time, save $1,500 and be one of the first 100 callers to get a free gift with purchase.
Call 1-800-581-6578. That's 1-800-581-6578.
Welcome back. Well, USDA says U.S. farmers are on pace to harvest one of the largest crops ever. Now, this is pretty impressive considering many key growing areas saw their fair share of weather challenges this year.
ASA President Richard Wilkins farms in Greenville, Delaware. And while he's had a good year, he says living and farming in the Chesapeake and Delaware Bays comes with its own set of unique challenges.
Yeah, you can see the height of the soybeans, they were stressed and stunted for so long.
Harvest is always Richard Wilkins' favorite time of year. But this year, the American Soybean Association's incoming president knows yields are going to be down for at least one crop at his Greenwood, Delaware operation.
Our soybeans are probably going to be 5 to 10 bushels an acre lower than what their APH yield history has been.
Despite the challenges this growing season, Wilkins is living his dream.
It's my dream profession. It always has been since I was just a young child.
The Wilkins family has worked the soil along the East Coast since immigrating here from Europe decades ago.
Until it hit me when my father, when I was 16 years old, he sat me down and he said, you know, I want you to do something else, but if your ambition is to be a farmer, you're going to have to figure out a way to do it on your own.
And that's what he did.
My first 3 acres of land that I rented as a FFA project, soybeans was the crop that I grew there.
Renting ground, growing, and diversifying the operation.
I had other career choices that I could have taken, but this was my passion, this was my love, and fortunately I met a young lady that also shared that vision and that passion.
Throughout our whole marriage, I have done almost everything on the farm.
A partnership that goes beyond the beans. Uh-huh. The pair run a retail seed and feed farm store.
Most days I would probably be in the store waiting on customers.
They grow multiple crops, including vegetables and lima beans.
We had dryness hit us in August and September, so we had a lot of blossoms and pods drop off the lima beans.
Beans that don't make the grade end up back at the farm as feed for their herd of cows and calves.
Oh, I'm thankful every day for my family and for the opportunities that we have to be able to live, the life that we have. And farming is a great life, and it's a great family life.
A great life.
When you're going through the field, that's how you can really analyze what worked, what didn't work.
With challenges and rewards. Regardless of yields, this Delawarean farm family rolls through another harvest season, thankful for the opportunity to participate in this great American industry one more year.
All right, when we come back, we're off to the Texas Panhandle, where farmers are thankful for more than just good crops. But first, we're off to Michigan, where a fellow farmer is still recovering from a recent brain tumor, but with the help of area farmers, 300 acres were rescued this fall.
Join us this year as we talk to growers about this year's growing season and the decisions they're making on their journey to harvest. Sponsored by DuPont Pioneer.
We're a little west of Charlotte, North Carolina, right near the South Carolina border. Every soybean is double cropped. We have 1,300 acres of wheat, and the beans are planted right into the wheat stubble. This is our fourth year with the Liberty program. We have a resistance to Palmer pigweed in this part of the country. The Liberty will annihilate the Palmer. That was our number one problem. And we've switched over. This is our fourth year, and we have clean fields. And when you have clean fields, you can have yield. First time we sprayed Liberty, we killed every Palmer plant that we sprayed. We were 50% 4 years ago, 75% 3 years ago, and the last 2 years we've been 100% Liberty, and wouldn't want to go back.
Hi friends, it's Machinery Pete inviting you to check out my all-new website, machinerypete.com. In the past, I've been your trusted advisor for auction prices and used equipment values, and now we've added a comprehensive online search experience with over 60,000 quality used farm equipment listings searchable for free. Dealers, we've got the innovative online marketing solutions you need to better market your brand and your equipment listings. Visit the new site today at machinerypete.com.
There's enough worries facing growers today. SDS shouldn't be one of them. Introducing Olevo, the first and only seed treatment to protect against sudden death syndrome with nematode activity. Growers get amazing early season protection for stronger profits at harvest. So worry about your equipment, or weather, or commodity prices. Don't worry about SDS with Olevo from Bayer Crop Science. Pair Olevo with Poncho Votivo for triple action protection against SDS, insects, and nematodes.
Welcome back. You know, farming in the Southern Plains isn't for the faint of heart. Consecutive years of drought ravaged crop yields, leaving farmers and ranchers with little hope of success. However, this year, Mother Nature reversed course, providing ample rainfall for a good year.
Clinton, I was fortunate enough to travel to the Texas Panhandle this fall. I interviewed National Sorghum Producers Chairman James Bourne, and he told me the issue this year wasn't finding enough bushels. It was discovering enough space to store it all.
For Texas Panhandle farmer James Bourne, it's not about raising the biggest crop every year.
Keep your head up, Evan.
It's about teaching the next generation lessons that aren't found in any textbook.
Yeah. Thankful for my family being here with me on the farm, that we can run and manage and operate this farm as a family.
Hand in hand, James and his wife Dana take great pride in making everything they do a family affair. Bourne, a former ag teacher, is now the chairman of National Sorghum Producers, a job he doesn't take lightly. He farms in Perryton, which is known as the wheat heart of the nation.
I like to say that if wheat's in the heart, sorghum is the soul of this operation.
It has a hearty soul, withstanding multiple years of heartbreaking drought.
It's just programmed to be tough.
While drought is still fresh on Bourne's mind, 2015 turned out to bring many blessings, including rain.
And we received our annual average precipitation in the month of May and part of June.
While the weather shut off in August, Bourne says scorching temperatures took 15 to 20 bushels off the yield.
But still, this crop held on, thrived, and is going to be what looks like for the county a record sorghum crop.
And that could create what some view as a good problem: finding enough storage for it all.
In this county, we have a lot of acres planted. We have a lot of yield there, potential. And from here on up into southwest Kansas, I think there's going to be milo everywhere.
From a record crop to record demand.
It's been fun to be in the sorghum industry the last couple years.
Exports are another bright spot in 2015.
Typically, we export a third of our crop in sorghum. We exported over half of our crop this last year.
After traveling to some of the key export buyers, Bourne says there's just a certain attraction tied to the U.S. crop.
We have a high-quality sorghum. We have a sorghum that is consistent in its size and weight. I think our exporters do a good job of moving that sorghum out in a timely fashion and having a good quality end product for them.
While traveling is part of the job, coming home and admiring a year's work with his family by his side are the days he cherishes most.
It's a time we're all together, and that's why we do what we do.
Before we head to break, we have one more story of farmers coming together in a time of need. Mike Connor suffered a heart attack in mid-October with corn still in the field, but thanks to friends and family, harvest came in on time.
U.S. Farm Report is brought to you by BASF. Grow smart with BASF and get the most acre after acre, season after season.
So, we're the first soybean brand of our kind.
Yep, called Credenz. We're backed by Bayer Crop Science.
We stand up better to tough weeds.
Because we've got the best choices in herbicide-tolerant traits.
We're better than your average soybeans.
Go to credenz.bayer.com to find a local retailer.
We are producers. Independent thinkers. And big picture dreamers. We're about getting things done, challenging traditions, and starting a few of our own. We are Kubota.
Introducing new Credenz soybeans, made using smart genetics. Credenz offers choices for handling tough weeds. They're not your average soybeans. Visit credenz.bayer.com to find your nearest retailer.
You're somewhere between trying to beat your previous best yield and trying to figure out how to beat the odds. You love working the land, but hate wasting effort. What's the smartest way forward? We're here to help you challenge the status quo and raise the bar on what's possible. We're BASF. You're drowning in options. We give you a personalized plan. You hear big promises every day. We deliver some of the best chemistry in agriculture. You face big risks. We put skin in the game to help protect you. Let's dream of places you can go on land you'll never leave. Let's grow smart together. Because the chemistry we create on your farm is just as important as the chemicals we create in the lab. Together, let's get you the most, acre after acre, season after season, generation after generation. BASF, we create chemistry.
In the hustle and bustle of today's fast-paced world, it's easy to forget how much time and effort used to go into producing products a century ago.
So true, but Al Pell takes us to northern Indiana to show us a gem that still shows the daily grind that goes into our daily bread.
Modern agriculture relies on raw energy to power the machines that plant the crops and reap the harvest. So let's look at a time whenever water was the driving force. Built in the mid-1830s, Bonneville Mill served farmers in northern Indiana and southern Michigan as a feed mill, a center of commerce, and a gathering place to spin yarns and share news.
You know, not only were they grinding your grain for you, that was a great gathering place for the people to come, you know, and a lot of the little towns and communities, that's how they developed, was around that grist mill.
John Jenny is the miller and historical interpreter. 30 years on the job, he knows about as much about the history of this place as anyone.
What makes it kind of unique is the fact that it continued operating until 1967.
After it closed, a water conservation group purchased the property to ensure the land would never be developed. It was later donated to the county. It reopened in 1974 as a living history museum.
A lot of kids nowadays don't know where their food comes from, you know, and you're starting to see some kids who sometimes don't know what a stalk of corn looks like.
The spinning stones still pulverize corn, rye, and a variety of wheat, about 5 tons annually. This is Al Pell.
Thanks so much, Al. Well, when we come back, we're off to John's farm for a lesson about gratitude and how it can make all of our lives richer.
U.S. Farm Report is brought to you by Kubota Hay Tools. Forage forward.
What if your elderly parent is one of the 1 in 3 seniors that have a fall at home or experience a burglary or fire? What if an accident happens away from home with no one around to help, possibly for hours? Any one of these scenarios can be a terrifying experience. Now take the what if out of any emergency anywhere with MedWatch, which now protects you at home and away. Simply press your MedWatch button or use the new automatic fall detection. And within seconds, you're speaking hands-free to the care center. Emergency services are notified as well as family and friends. Help arrives in minutes.
Finally, I can be independent and never feel alone.
It gives us all peace of mind.
Call now and receive the MedWatch equipment at no charge, including free shipping. And if yours is one of the first 100 orders, have your setup fee waived and receive a free lockbox. Even get over $3,000 in grocery savings.
Call 1-800-493-9362. That's 1-800-493-9362.
At Thanksgiving, we often make a mental inventory of things we're thankful for, but it's also a good time to run down a list of people we should be thankful to.
It's a good thing to annually take stock of the blessings in our lives
And Thanksgiving gives us a great occasion to make that inventory and acknowledge with gratitude how much we have. But this year, I find myself wanting, in addition, to say thanks to some special people who add more to my life than possessions can possibly bring. First, I want to say thanks to all of you who preserve the increasingly rare courtesy of extending the benefit of the doubt. Cutting others some slack is not in fashion in the current atmosphere of nearly instantaneous hot takes on every development. Those who withhold judgment and comment because they think they might have misunderstood or misheard, those who allow for the possibility of an innocent mistake, or those who can admit they just don't know enough to form an opinion are friends to be treasured, and I do. In addition, thank you to all of you who pay attention to conversations or presentations without checking your phone or tablet. This has become one of the highest forms of respect, and I think it lifts our interactions to a welcome level of dignity and efficiency. Thank you to all of you who think beyond your time, from planting a hardwood tree to installing drainage tile or terraces to working to cope with climate change. These are actions that lift our eyes to very distant horizons and remind us we are linked to those who follow us, and that the world will not end when we're not around. Finally, I want to say thank you to all of you who simply show up. While I appreciate what the internet has done to help us communicate with each other, there is a reason why we call very moving personal experiences touching. There is still an enormous value in being with each other, and those touches are a powerful balm for wounded spirits. From all of us here in Prairie Township, happy Thanksgiving, and thank you.
Beautifully said. Thanks so much, John. As always, from our family to yours, our sincerest thanks to the farmers, ranchers, and businesses that do everything they can to keep this industry alive. We hope that your harvest is full of thanks and your blessings bountiful.
Your hard work, your dedication, your passion, it's all appreciated by us here at this program and across the entire Farm Journal family. Thank you for all that you do to ensure our tables are full and our time with family is special this Thanksgiving.
High-strength steel for high-strength dependability. Chevy Silverado, the official news gathering vehicle of U.S. Farm Report.